It's not only about where you meet. Many years ago, I met different house church movements, and I become more part of those house church movement. And you know, I came to a point where first I saw that something was off with the traditional church. I saw it's not biblical. I was frustrated. There must be more than this. I study, and saw through church history and books and different books. And there is a book I actually want to recommend. It's Pagan Christianity. Frank Viola is a good book. Wolfgang Simpson, he wrote a book called How Churches Have Changed the World. Neil Cole, he wrote a book called Organic Churches. And there's many different books out there. But what I saw was that I was disappointed toward this and thought it was not good biblical this. And I heard about the house church and house church network. And later I shifted from there to there. And when I finally saw the house churches, I got so disappointed. I just got disappointed. I'm like, what is this? Is this church? Is this what we want? If this is church, I'd rather have the big church. I miss the big church. I miss the worship. I want the big one. If church should be sitting in a home with people and singing Kumbaya in years with the same 10 people, and it's just many house churches is just a model of the tradition church. Just you, what do you actually do? You change the wine skin. Jesus in Matthew 9, he's talk about that we don't put new wine into old wine skin. Why not? Because then the skins will burst. That we need, and the wine will run out. And then he said, no, you put new wine into new wine skin to preserve both of them. I know Jesus is talking about the law there and that context, but he's talking about the system, he's talking about the new thing God is doing. If you look at, he said, we have the wine and we have the wine skin. What did I see? I saw old wine skin, the tradition church, with all the things that came together with that tradition church, and I did not like it. It was not what I read in Book of Acts. There was something off. It was a mix of pagan religion and traditions and other things. And then I left that and I came to the house church movement. And what happened? I got really, really disappointed. Why? Because what did we do in the house church movement? We changed the wineskin. But what about the wine? It was still own wine. Now we did not have old wine on old wineskin. Now we have old wine on new wineskins. We did not have the new wine. What is the wine? The wine is everything you put in the wineskin. If you look at it like that, look at the frames of our church is the wineskin, the frames, the building, the traditions, the meetings, the programs, everything we see around it, that is somehow the frame of the church. But the frame in itself, you can have a new wineskin, you can have a new structure, you can be very organic and very free and then miss out of everything. Why? There's no gospel. There's no Holy Spirit. There's no healing the sick. There's no casting out demons. There's no going out. There's no mission. There's no making disciples. All of that is just missing. And I think this is the thing we see as a problem, that there's many people who have tried house church and they think, hey, I've tried house church, been there, done that, and don't like it. I want to move on now. Because it was just they tried the wineskin, but they never really tasted the wine. I will talk more about what the wine is. But if you then, the wine is, I wrote a new book just called The Call of Jesus. If you don't have it, you can get it on Amazon or on thelastrevmason.com. And if you don't have the money, write to us on mail at thelastrevmason.com. You can get it for free. And I'm doing a whole series about this video series. There I talk about the call of Jesus, the whole call of being mission focus, the call of obeying Him, the call of taking up the cross, the call of denying ourselves, the call of being led by the Holy Spirit, the call of listening to the Spirit, preaching the full gospel, and going out, mission, healing the sick, casting out demons, persecution, growing people up, that people come in and become a part of family and growing up to maturity, and all of this. All of this, I'm talking about that book, and I would say all of this is the wine, new wine. But if you take this call of Jesus, where he talk about going out, he say cast out demon, making disciples, everyone can do ministry, it's not only the priest, everyone can hear from God, it's not only the priest. And the whole idea behind what Jesus called church of created community. If you take this new wine and put it on the own wineskin, you are going to break that system big times. And the new wine would get spilled. We had tried a few times. When we came to America around 1 year ago, I met our friend in Florida. He's pastor in a small church, and he asked me if I could come and work with the church. And I said, I would love to. So we came down to Florida, and we were down in Florida, and we met him. Three Tuesdays, we should be together with the people in the church. And it was really, really cool. It was cool. I came in, and he have gathered 50 people from his church, and I came in and I said, okay guys, what I'm focused on those three Tuesdays is how to heal the sick, cast out demon, preach the gospel, lead people to Christ, baptize people in water, baptize people in the Holy Spirit, how to make disciples. And I said, there's much more in discipleship than this. There is about family, there is about servanthood, there is about being faithful. There's so many more things we could talk about when it comes to church, but I said, this is what I want to focus on now, and I'm going to train you in those things now. And I did some teaching. I took people up, prayed for people, people got set free, healed, set free. I took some people out on the streets a few days later. We did a WhatsApp group, and people start to share testimony, and testimonies came in. People got healed, people got set free, people got baptized water, people got baptized Holy Spirit, and so beautiful things happen. What happened? It was not everyone who liked it. And it ended up that it became a big mess. 7 people left the church. Out of those 15, and 50 who was there, 7 people left. Yes! 30 new people got baptized in 1 month, and new things start to happen, and that was beautiful, that is powerful. But people started to leave. Why? Because they were part of their own wineskin, they were part of their own system, they were part of that own old thing, and they don't want revival, they don't want the new things. That was not what they signed up for, that was not why they come in church and pay the tithe. They want to come and pay the tithe so the pastor can go and hear from God and come and tell what God is saying, and they don't want to lift a finger themselves. And when changes happen, it became a mess. And I've seen that again and again. We just gave out a video with a Methodist pastor. If you're not seeing it, I recommend it. It's on YouTube. Oh, there's some kids playing, a lot of noise here. We just gave out a video on YouTube just a few weeks ago with a Methodist pastor who had been a pastor for 25 years. And then he's starting to experience this life. Baptize people in water, Holy Spirit, make disciples, going out on the street, and he got fired. He got thrown out from the church. Why? Because the old wineskin don't wanted the new wine. And this is what we have seen again and again. We have seen so many churches want this life, pastors or elders, or people, members in the church who want it. And then suddenly they experience it just fall from each other. Why? Because they've been praying for revival for years, and when it came, they did not want it. It's like the Pharisees. Welcome all of you who's new. I'll just speak a little more and then I will hear your questions. It's like the Pharisees who are studying scripture daily. waiting for Messiah, and when Messiah stood in front of them, they said, crucify him. Why? Because it was not that kind of Messiah they wanted. It was not that kind. They wanted somebody they could control a little more, or somebody who was according to their system and their way of thinking. So they were studying scripture, they were waiting for Messiah to come, and he came and they crucified him. Many people are starting revival, they are waiting for revival, they are praying.
Hey,
guys, can you go another place and be quiet? Hi, there's a lot of noise here, a lot of kids running around right now. They were waiting for Messiah to come. They were waiting for Messiah to come, and when he came, they crucified him. And I think this is what we see in the church today, that many people are praying for revival. They want revival. They're longing for revival. They want to see a new church arrives. But when it starts to happen, they are not going to like it. Why? Because it's not the way they expected it. So let me move on, and then I will take your questions. So what do I see happen with the church today? We are living in a time where the economy is going to break. It's going to change big times. We are living with a time where there's going to be a lot of control. Why? Because economy and control is often connected. And there is many churches today, the only reason they can be a church and survive the way they do it is because they get a lot of tax benefit from the government, from the states. I see that in Lutheran church especially, and the system in Europe, but also in America, that people get tax benefit, and priests get a lot of tax benefit, they don't have to pay a lot in tax, and there's a lot of things here. When it's going to be persecuted on the church, and they're going to start to do something about that, many are going to compromise. This is just how it is. Many are going to compromise, and the church are going to, there's two churches. One big church are going to go under the system. One big church are going to compromise big time and go under and just be like the church we saw it in China, not the house church, but the other church who was controlled by the system. But there is also a remnant. There is also a group of people who are being called out, who really want God, who are being called out, who say, I don't want this system. I want to be a disciple. I want to be honest. I want to live with Jesus. I want to die for Jesus. I want to make disciples. And that is the church I want to talk about. And maybe you are part of that. Maybe you are part of that church. Maybe you are in a place where you feel like, hey, there's more. There I want to say that it's not about only meeting the homes. It's not about where you meet. It's really also about what do you do when you come together. Our main focus is not to build churches. That have never been our calling. Jesus has never said, go and make churches. Our main focus have always to make disciples. So our focus is to make disciples. Jesus will then build his church. So we make disciples, Jesus build a church. We make disciples, Jesus build a church. We can try to build a church and have a church, but we are not making disciples. What is the fruit of a real church? It's disciples. Is people who obey God. So if you're in a church right now and say, if we look at that church, if we remove the church building and don't get cheated by how big and fancy that is, if we remove the meetings and don't get cheated by the activities, if we remove the economy, don't get cheated by how many money they have, if we remove the how many people attend the church, don't get cheated by that, because Jesus did not have a church building. He did not have big economy and activities, and he did not have a lot of people. If we remove some of all of those things and then look at not the numbers of people, but look at the obedience among those people who are there, look at the disciples, then we see what we really have. Then we see what we really have. If we look at the disciples, not what they do on Sunday, but how do they obey Jesus Monday? How do they share the gospel Tuesday? How do they live by the Holy Spirit Wednesday? How do they pray and fast Thursday? How do they love their neighbor as themselves Friday? How do they live this life from Monday to Sunday 24/7? If we then look at that, then we really, really, really see the true picture. And my experience is, if we try to forget everything that had to do with church and just put everything away and say, okay, I'm actually not doing church anymore. Now I will try to do something else. I'll try to just make disciples. I'll try to just share my life with people, share my experience with people. I will try to get people to grow up in maturity in Christ. And then I will try to take those people and obey Christ myself together with those people. And together, you come together and you obey Christ together. And of course, you share the word and you break the bread and focus on God, have communion and so on. If you just focus on that, congratulations, you have church.